Praise the Lord, this is Elder Sister Debbie. There's a heaven again, the Bible says, and there's a hell to shun. This earth is 4.5 billion years old. Mankind is less than 6,000 in this earth. And out of all the galaxies and all the planets that's in our Milky Way, and there are so many beyond us, that God could have given life to, He chose this planet. And He made sure this star keeps shining its sun upon us. The kingdom of God sits in the fabric of darkness. Job said it's beyond the Orion constellation. If you know anything about the zodiacs, there's a constellation that is in the Orion sector. And beyond the Orion sector, it says they have nothing but matter and antimatter and darkness. Well, in the fabric of that darkness sits the kingdom of God. It's this huge providence that rests on nothing but its own self. Hanging in the fabric of darkness, shining where there is no star to give it light. And in that kingdom, there's a God. We know Him to be Father, the Almighty, the Utmost High. And then He has a Son, and His name is Jesus. There's also the Holy Spirit. The Bible says He's the seven spirits of God. And the seven spirits of God stays before His throne constantly to hear what God has to say concerning you and concerning this planet. And then the Bible also states that there are 24 elders. And outside the 24 elders, you know there are 12 apostles. The Bible says that they are institutions that are up there. And the pillars and the foundations have their names carved in it. There's a real city. There's a real kingdom. That's beyond the Orions. Amen. Hey, Mike. And hanging in that fabric of darkness, there's a kingdom that belongs to God. There's no star there that would give it light. Like we have the sun, which is a star, and it gives us light. And yet, in a moment of a twinkle of an eye, within the thought, angels are going back and forth from the kingdom of God to this earth, trying to lead men into righteousness, trying to turn their path from destruction. And the Bible says that the angels are even warring against the kingdom of darkness that have come into contract and covenant with evil rulers and kingdoms, such as Russia and China. These particular kingdoms, for example, and the Arabian kingdoms, for example, they have evil rulers, wicked men, and Satan powers their hands. But the kingdom of God has hosts of angels, and they swing that sword all day long. While you sleep and slumber, while you walk this earth unconcerned, there's angels that are battling just for you to prevent accidents, accidental shootings, robberies, rapes, things we walk ourselves into. And then there are snares that are set by the enemy every day for your life. Satan's main goal is to make you fall into everlasting damnation. There is a heaven to gain, and there is a hell that we need to shun away from. Some of us are ignorantly embracing hell. Some of us are boldly embracing that place called hell. Father God has three big houses, and these three big houses are prisons And these prisons are on this earth. We are not in the earth, we are walking upon the earth. In the hull of this earth, in the middle of it, it's nothing but melting lava. Caverns full of fire that is made out of pillars. And this particular place that we know to be hell, you're walking on it every day. And yet there is another prison. Now you have what we call the lake of fire. And if you know anything about volcanoes, there's a lake of fire that comes out of them. Liquid fire. And it's so hot that it disintegrates even rocks and turn them into liquid. The strongest metal cannot restrain from the power of that fire. That is called the lake of fire. And it's in the midst, deep, deep, deep under our feet. It flows everywhere. We see that breakthrough sometimes. We have volcanoes, rocks that they shoot itself out of. There's lakes and rivers that may not be near us, but in other countries and lands, the earth is opening up and this hot lake of fire is boiling the water and making it unclean, unsanitized even to drink. The smell of the sulfur is so strong it would kill you. It's an inhabitable part of the land. I know you may not be aware of that. You probably only know Marrero. But there are places on this earth that's not even inhabitable because of the sulfur, because of the salt contents, because the minerals that are in this earth are so pure. So in the whole of this earth that we live in, there is a lake of fire that flows all under our feet. That is one prison. There and above that one is called the place called hell. Now hell itself, even though it has caverns that's going in and out, there are compartments in which there are certain sinners and abominations. They are chained, locked down into rocks, hidden in darkness. So hell has its own kingdom down there. It's the largest cell there is. Angola is nothing. And none of the other big houses that we call on this earth isn't anything compared to the prison that God calls hell. Now, if you can even imagine the size of the earth, that's the size of that prison. Inside that place, there are compartments. There's a place that is called Hades. There's a place that is called Tartarus. These are compartments. The Bible states that, and even Enoch, the scribe of righteousness, wrote that God was so angry with the angels that were supposed to be helping mankind in the beginning because they slept with the women and began to create giants on the earth, such as Goliath. He was so wroth with them that he took them and told Michael and Gabriel and Zaphiel to take them and go bring them into the midst of the desert. He said, bury them underneath jagged rocks in the earth and chain them down into that darkness. And then they will stay there until all this earth will be judged. And still they're down there over 6,000 years now. Jesus spoke of places like Hades, Tartarus, in there the giants are held, what we call the gods of this earth, such as Goliath and the king of Og. The Bible states that in the book of Kings that the king of Og was 14 feet tall, He has 6 fingers and 6 toes. His beard alone was over 17 feet long. It's written right there in the Bible. So they have been giants, and these giants were created by the angelic beings that decided they were going to sleep with the women of the earth. Because of their abomination and their lust, God punished them. And they're today, a little over 6,000 years, they are still sitting in that place of darkness, waiting for judgment. So what happened to the sons and the children of the giants? The Bible says, and Enoch wrote it down, he said that God was so wroth with them. These angels pleaded God that when their children would die, would they return and ascend back to the kingdom of God? God said, no. They are abominations. He called them unclean spirits and evil ones. So God punished the children of the giants and said that when they die, they will stay in the earth. They will neither rise, neither will they go into the hole of the earth, but they will roam without rest until the time of judgment. And this is when you get your unclean spirits and your demons and your devils. These are the children, these are the spirits of these children. Gives us a glimpse, and Jesus gave us a glimpse of heaven. He spoke more about hell and the kingdom of God than anything else. He said that, you know, the kingdom of God is like this. See, the owner of everything set up a field, and he allowed the vineyards to grow and the harvest to flourish. And then he hired servants to come and to tend the field, to tend the crop, to gather them, to take that which is unprofitable and remove it. Jesus continued to say that, but the servants, the hirelings, that the keeper of the land sent and set up, they began to be killed by those that inhabited the land. They began to kill the prophets. They began to kill the evangelists. They began to kill the apostles. But then God said, you know, if I send my son down there, surely they wouldn't kill him. They would honor him and they would listen. But the Bible says they will take the son and they will do whatever they will to him. This is the parable that Jesus spoke about Father and how he felt about this place called earth. How he sent servants, how he put laws and precepts in places. He put elders there to till the land, to raise the people, to grow the harvest of souls. But they slay them, they kill them, and they don't listen to them. And God said, well, I'll just send my son. Surely they will respect my son. But the Bible says, Jesus said, they will do to him as they please. And so it was. There is a heaven to gain, and there is a hell that you need to shun. Some of us are embracing hell. We have this concept that if I'm bad enough to do the crime, I'm bad enough to do the time. But you don't understand that in this imprisonment, there is no time. There is no parole. There is no shortening of your leave there. There is no 3 meals a day, a bath, and exercise. There's no one to talk to or comfort you. You're going in a place, the Bible says, there's nothing but torment. So in the whole of this earth, there is this liquid fire that is called the lake of fire. Also in this earth, right underneath your feet as you walk every day, there are caverns that are cut in the hull of this earth. Those places of what God called hell. And hell is a prison. It's a prison for souls. Now the Bible says at first it was not made for man. But as men continue to sin from the time of Adam, the prophet wrote, now hell is enlarging itself. Because of men's disobedience, because they embrace hell and they refuse to repent. In those compartments of hell, there's Tartarus. That's for the what we call the titans of the world. And then there are those that are set for certain other people in the world. It's amazing how a prison that was not set up for the souls of men to go into, God has made provision that you can have a nice place to live. And you will stay there without time. Above the place called hell, which is a prison, there's a place that was called paradise. You're talking about levels that are inside this earth that we are living in. The place called paradise was where the saints were from the time of the flood. Because there was no provision made for mankind to be ascended to heaven. So those that died in righteousness and in faith of God, keeping his precepts, raising their children to keep their precepts, to remember God, they were kept in the place that was called paradise. Paradise is away from the fires of hell. It's nowhere near the lake of fire that runs underneath our feet, that shoots out, that causes earthquakes and splits the earth. And in this place called paradise is where the saints of God will stay. Abraham was there. There was those that was there since the time of the flood, the Bible says, in which only 8 souls really were saved. But God is so magnificent and so beyond our imagination. The Bible says there were 2 of them. One was named Elijah and the other name was Enoch. That he didn't even allow to die. Their body saw no corruption. They did not go through death. They just was translated in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, from one state of being to another. And Isaiah, Elena will be the 2 witnesses that will come, the Bible says in the book of Revelation, and they will walk the cities of Jerusalem to bear witness against them. It's amazing. See, everybody don't have to die. God knows just how to get it all done. So he took these 2 righteous men that he allowed to be born for the very purpose of setting up a kingdom. And he says, Elijah and Enoch, you will walk the cities of Jerusalem and you will witness against them. The Bible said they will begin to preach and teach against them and bear witness of their sins. This is in the book of Revelation. And the people of Jerusalem become so mad. The Jews will become so angry. The Bible said they will kill them and allow their bodies to lay in the street for 3 days and for 3 nights. But then God will raise them back up again and they would go through the rest of the city of Jerusalem, calling down fire and judgment to the people of Israel. Wow. Now, we have many people that call themselves prophets and messiahs on this earth. But unless you can prophesy 6,000 years ahead of time, I don't think you have any, not even an inch, to touch the power and majesticness of our true Messiah, who is Jesus. Muhammad is not the Messiah. He never was. Buddha is not the high priest. He never was. These men died, and their body have saw corruption. And if you dig their graves, their bones are still there. The evidence of the Messiah that was prophesied before Jesus was even to be born said that his body won't even see corruption, and God will not allow his soul to stay in hell. I promise you, your messiahs are still in hell, and so are your prophets. So there is the lake of fire, which is that molten lava that runs in the midst of this earth. God said he's going to throw all prisons inside of that fire. So there is a greater punishment that's coming. But the big houses that God has that is in this earth right now, one of them is hell. It's for the prisoning of the souls. The second place, the Bible says, is called the grave, where the body sees corruption. So there are souls, people that have died since the beginning of time, that have died, have never repented of their sins, have never taken and put their names in the Lamb's Book of Life, using the blood of Jesus as the ransom to buy them back from slavery. The Bible says that in the grave, those bodies are still there. And the grave has a right to hold them because they're unrighteous. But their souls are in hell. There's a separation of the body and the soul. When the body dies, this movement of flesh, when this body dies, there's a soul that separates itself from it. The soul is your consciousness, your awareness, your attitude, your conduct, your feelings, your perception. It looks through your eyes like a mirror and sees and comprehends. That is what your soul does. The Bible says that all spirits belong to God, and the spirit of a man is the breath of God that is in him. The Bible says he's going to collect all his spirits. Whether you are going to hell or not, he takes his breath back. Jesus said this in Psalms, the 10th chapter, the 16th verse. I'm going to enter it. We're looking at the 14th chapter of Psalms. In the 10th verse, it says, "For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption." Jesus said this to the disciples. He said, "Don't fear a man, don't fear anyone that can kill your body. You know, that can destroy it. They can shoot it. They can drown it. They can choke it. You can die of an overdose." He said, don't fear the fact that your body dies. He said, you need to fear the one that can take your body and your soul and throw it into hell. This is how the judgment of God will be. He will take your body that you're walking around in And he will take your soul, which is your consciousness of everything that is going on, even the memory of things. And he's going to throw all that into hell. So while you are in eternity, a place that has no time, you will constantly relive the horrors of your death, the rejection of Christ. You'll be reminded of every pain and every sorrow. And you will continually have a memory of that. That is one of the punishments. Only God can take your body and your soul and cast it into hell. But Jesus said, God will not leave my soul in hell, and he will not leave my body in the grave. So when Jesus was put into the sepulchers after his crucifixion, after the third day, Mary of Magdalene and all the disciples, they come running to the sepulcher, and they saw no body. Where is the body of Jesus? Who took it? No one raises from the dead. Nobody comes out of the grave. There was one person. Matter of fact, there was several people that Jesus raised from the dead. One was the son of a widow. There was a funeral procession that was going through the city, and the mourners was walking before the body as it laid upon this slab. And they were carrying the body through the city while his mother was crying behind him. It was her only son, Jesus said. The Bible said that Jesus went and he laid his hand just on the barrels of that slab. And that dead son woke up and he presented that son back to that widow again. Then, of course, there was Lazarus that you're probably more familiar with. That after he died, he was wrapped in grave clothes because that was the order of things. And Jesus went to the sepulchre and began to call him from the place of imprisonment. Why was that even possible? Nobody raised people from the dead. Well, there was another, and his name was the prophet Elijah. The son that a widow, that a woman that was granted, the son that never had a child before, that child died of a heat stroke while in the field with his father. She went and she sought out the prophet Elijah that prophesied that son to her. Elijah came to the woman's house and saw where the dead child was laying in his bed. The Bible says that he walked in there and he stretched himself on the body of that child. He was face to face, nose to nose, and mouth to mouth. He did that seven times. The first time he did it, that child did not rise. He came back one more time. He did it again. That child did not rise. He left that child where it was laying, and he walked out again, knowing that God is a God of miracles, trusting him and trusting the prayers of the prophets, the servants of God. And he went and he laid upon him seven times. And on that seventh time that he laid upon that child, eyes to eyes and nose to nose and mouth to mouth, he stretched his hand from fingertip to fingertip. He laid his legs across his toes. And he laid as one that was dead, but one that was giving life. And the Bible said that child woke up and sneezed 7 times. There is no laws of death. And what I mean about laws of death, there is no law in which death can hold you down. Jesus can raise the dead. Servants can raise the dead. They were snatched from a place of corruption. That was even before Jesus came. Showing that God is the giver and the taker of life. He is the creator, and he will be the destroyer of things. Do you know him today? And set up by Jesus Christ, under the guidance of the Father, with the help of the Holy Spirit and with the angels. In John chapter 14, verse 1, it says, "Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, then believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions, and if it was not so, I would not have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, then I have to come back again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also." Father God has 3 big houses that he put the souls of men in. One is called hell, which is a huge prison under the earth. The very earth you're walking on, you're walking above it. There was a place that was called paradise. That place is no more. It has been emptied. In the place of paradise was where the righteous was kept from the time of the flood. During that time, there was only 8 souls that was there. But then Abraham died and Sarah died and on and on and on. And as the righteous died, they were brought to the place called paradise. There was a tribe of Israel that is no more. Because of their disobedience and their rebellion, the Bible says that God says because they rebelled so, he just opened up the earth and swallowed the whole clan up, over 1 million people, and let them fall straight into this imprisonment. So hell is quite full, but the Bible says it just keeps getting bigger. There was not a man that ever claimed to be the Messiah, the Savior, that died and then was risen again. There's only one that was begotten from the dead. And his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of God, the only true Son of God. There is not another that has been begotten, not from the dead. The righteousness and the holiness that is required by God for us to live is not to be taken lightly. We want to live the ways of God, but we want to live it upon our own terms. We still want to destroy our vessels. We still want to live a life of immorality. And yet we still want to claim that we are children of God. But is God calling you one of his children? Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Now, if I'm going to prepare a place for you, I must be coming back. So, the place called paradise is no more. It has been emptied. And yet God is powerful and miraculous. He is amazing and majestic. He is holy, and he is one that cannot even bear to be looked upon. In the book of Revelation, Jesus began to describe as a prophet, as one that is a true prophet of God, as one that is the Messiah, the true evangelist, the true witness. He began to lay the foundation of that which will be, and there is not another that can do that. Before he left, he told the disciples, he said, the unholy one is coming, so I'm not going to speak much with you right now. I'm not going to reveal everything to you. The Bible says if they knew that by the death of Jesus, he would gain victory and win back mankind, they would have never crucified him. They would have never killed him. Satan never knew the whole plan of God. Whatever wisdom and knowledge and understanding he had, it was limited to his occupation as a chief angel and the things that he had to do. We need to build ourselves up, the Bible says. You must build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. What they mean about praying in the Holy Ghost is praying by the leadership of him. The Bible says men don't even know what to pray for. But the Spirit of God, who searches the heart and the mind of the Father, and knows the heart of men, knows what to ask of God concerning each and individual person. You must build up yourselves on your most holy faith. But you must pray in the Holy Ghost. Jesus spoke about praying prayers that are vain, constantly asking for things that he's already given release of. Now, it's not that you should not ask of these things, but why are your prayers continually about these things? Instead of saying as David was, God, I know that you are my shield. Father, I know that you are my buckler. Father, I know that the host of angels is about me, and you have come to protect me from my enemies. Why are we still saying, God, protect me from my enemies? We need to learn to pray with exhortation. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray with knowledge. Amen. We must also keep ourselves in the love of God and looking for the mercy of the Lord unto eternal life. The Bible says in the book of Jude, and Jude only wrote one letter. He wrote concerning how Satan wanted the body of Moses. Going to the general epistle of Jude, he wrote only one letter. And it reads, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, and the brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ, and called, mercy unto you, and peace and love may be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which we was once delivered unto the saints. There are many that are saying that they know the man. If it was not for Jesus, where would they be? God has spared and saved their lives. But are you contending for the faith in which you say that you have? Our faith is centered around the works of Jesus Christ and the God that is omnipotent. We need to contend for that faith and stop committing adultery with your faith. You want to have faith in God, faith in the saints, faith in the Cowboys. You want to have faith in everything but Jesus. And yet you say that you have faith in God. And yet the words of another will rule over the eternal words of God that is written down. That says, I have paid for your freedom. And yet you stay in captivity. Jesus had taken every sickness by 39 stripes, and yet you say that God gave you the sickness. How are you contending for the faith if you keep speaking in contention against it? Jude continued to say that for there are certain men that have crept, and it was unawares, who were before all of old and ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men. And they were turning the grace of God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. If you are contending for the faith, then why are you committing spiritual adultery? We like to say that the word of God is unadulterated, which means that we have not entangled any other seeds with it, any other spiritual doctrine and unbeliefs. We're supposed to keep it pure and undefiled from the world. And yet Jude spoke of certain men that were of old, that was before, that they were ordained to this condemnation. They were ungodly men, and they began to turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. In the book of Titus, chapter 1, verse 16, it says, Jude continues and says, Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the error of Balaam, for rewards, and they perish in their gainsaying of Korah. Genesis chapter 4, verse 5. Genesis chapter 4, verse 5 says, But unto Cain and unto his offerings, he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Second Peter, chapter 2, verse 15. Which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam and the son of Beor, who love the wages of unrighteousness. Many today are doing the same. Jude writes about the state of the houses of God and the hearts of the people of God. They rather take up with untruths. They rather follow teachings and doctrines that sways them away from the written word of God. They rather vex their righteous soul as the Holy Spirit is constantly convicting them of the sin that they're going into. They blot him out until they become reprobate, which means they're not going to hear him anymore. Holy Spirit's not going to talk to you no more. You go on until your time of destruction. These are spots in your feast of charity, and they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruits wither and without fruit, twice dead and plucked up by the roots. You are raging waves of sea, forming out their own shame, and wandering stars out of their own, and which you are reserved for the blackness of the darkness forever. And Enoch, also the seventh from Adam, prophesied these sayings. Say, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. And when he's come, he's going to catch many of those that claim to be children of God, believers in Christ, followers of the way, been called unto ministry, and living a life that is a reproach unto the occupations in which they've been called. Vexing their righteous souls, still dabbling around with deities, still sprinkling salt in front of their houses for evil spirits, still dabbling around with those that give dark counsel and evil counsel, still mixing themselves up with sinners and living in the midst of them. This is the state of mankind that Jude is talking about. He said, but I want to tell you something. Behold, he said, look for it. Because the Lord will come with 10,000s of his saints. And he's coming to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are the murmurers. These are the complainers. These are they that walk after their own lusts, and their mouth speaketh great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of their advantages. But beloved, remember the words which the Lord God has spoken by the apostles, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, which will walk after their own ungodly lusts. And these will be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. There are many that are claiming to be children of God, and you don't even have the Spirit of God. You have not been baptized, filled with the Spirit of God. You have walked according to your own thoughts, your own words, and your own gospel. And you have taught men to do the same thing. But Jesus will come, and when he returns, he's going to catch all of them in the state that they are in. And they will say, well, Lord, did we not cast out devils? Did we not pray for the sick? Were we not those that worked the communion table? Did we not pray the prayer of salvation? Did we not? And he gonna say, you did all those things. He said, but your iniquity was still in you. This is the reason why we need the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Jesus said that the Holy Ghost must come and live inside of you. Closing, Paul, John the Baptizer said that he only gives the baptism of repentance unto repentance, which is the baptism of water. He said, but there is coming another, and he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And he will have a fan in his hand, and it's to fire up the flame to burn the chaff, the uncleanness, and the iniquity that is still in you, that you may be presented before God a pure, a holy, and a perfect sacrifice, living upright and unto righteousness. This is Elder Sister Debbie, and this concludes our church for today, and I pray for mercy to be out tomorrow. You need to choose who you're going to serve. If you die in your sins, there is a place called hell. If you die on the earth, there's a place called hell. Jesus said it's a prison, and it holds the souls of men. And the grave that your mother and your grandmother and your uncle and your pastor is going to put you in, that's where your body's going to stay until judgment time. But if you die in the faith and contend for it, despite the evil that is continually moving in this earth, if you contend for the faith, hold fast to your faith in God, the righteousness in which you've been bestowed, continue to keep yourself separated in holiness from this world and the evil and the uncleanness there is, and trust the Holy Spirit to get you to your appointed end. This is Elder Sister Debbie. Choose you this day who you're going to serve.